In early times, evil spirits were thought to possess people and make them act in strange and frightening ways. By the 1800s, the study of this hysteria led some doctors to believe one person could have separately functioning personalities.
In this video, we are going to see how multiple personality disorder affects the lives of three different people. Gretchen, a single college student, is estranged from her daughter and is dealing with an alter who wants to kill her. John, a successful police officer whose illness has made it impossible to maintain a romantic relationship. And finally, Barb, a wife and mother who often is replaced by several alters the same age as her daughters. While all three have varying symptoms and situations, they share one thing in common: traumatic childhood sexual abuse.
In this rare research film from the 1920s, a woman has different personalities who believe they are separate people. One is a male who is not comfortable in women's clothes. Another is a small child. The affliction has been known by different names but recognized for centuries. Today, it is called multiple personality disorder. A college student has many personalities, and one of them wants to kill her. A 40-year-old policeman has, living within him, a tortured child.
But that's what you tell me.
A wife and mother becomes a 5-year-old who is just learning to write her name. Why have they become tormented and broken into different personalities? What is the childhood pain that lies buried in the unknown depths of their minds? How can they search for the deadly memories that hold the secrets of their past and the promise of their healing?
Twice a week, Gretchen walks across town to see her therapist. She can't afford a car because what little money she has goes for therapy. Gretchen is divorced and has 2 children who she hardly ever sees.
Gretchen's situation is not uncommon. Many people with multiple personality disorder find that their ability to work and maintain relationships suffer. Where children are concerned, it can be even more complicated. Sometimes the person feels too overwhelmed or guilty to raise their child. Sometimes the other parent or family member will sever those ties because of a lack of understanding of how this illness works. And in rare cases, one or more of the personalities may be neglectful or abusive to the child. However, each case is different, and actions must be taken on a case-by-case basis. Violence, while possible, is not the norm, and many people with this disorder have been able to successfully raise children with the support of loved ones.
It just hit me that I'm 34 and that I should be, you know, with my kids, mothering my kids, and I should already have a career and I should already be somewhere doing something.
For most of her adult life, Gretchen has had severe psychiatric problems. She's needed treatment for years, but doctors never agreed about why.
Okay, good time to come out.
I didn't know and I was waiting.
No, this is a good time. This is a good time. We were talking about anger.
I know I don't like...
2 years ago, Gretchen was diagnosed with multiple personality disorder. She struggles to function every day and is desperately trying to understand what is wrong. Gretchen's problems began when she was a child.
I always felt different. I didn't feel like I was like everyone else or anyone else. And I thought I was crazy, and I would hear that in my head too. We are so good at hiding ourselves and appearing normal. I don't want people to think I'm crazy. I don't want to appear abnormal in any way. I want to fit in.
All of these categories would be considered subordinate.
Gretchen has returned to school to finish her degree.
Engaging with art can reduce symptoms of anxiety, depression, and stress. In addition, using art as a form of expression can help people manage their mental and emotional well-being. Art can help a patient focus, as well as become a way to harness excess energy. Another benefit of art expression is that a person may be able to express, through their art, subjects that might otherwise be too uncomfortable or complex to articulate.
She is an honors student at a small college in upstate New York.
Okay. Anything else?
I want to clarify. I thought the subordinate was a higher, more general. And superordinate. Okay. I've got it backwards?
You got it backwards. Right. Superordinate.
Gretchen is also studying art and has classes in painting and sculpture.
It's difficult for me in school a lot. Something occurs in the class and we're instantly overwhelmed. I need to find a safe place. I need to run out of the room and find a safe place to be.
When Gretchen is in distress, she switches to a personality that is emotionally stronger.
This occurs in many cases. For instance, Christine Sizemore, most famous for inspiring the Three Faces of Eve, first recalls having an altar fully emerge to run and get help after her mother had a kitchen accident.
You know, if Gretchen's having a hard day, I come out and I go to class. I take exams, I study. And a lot of that's easier for me to do than it is for her. I just seem to pick up concepts faster. She gets so nervous and stuff.
An aggressive personality emerges when Gretchen must be assertive and handle stressful situations. The personality, who goes by the name of myself, is often hostile and critical of Gretchen.
She gets so overwhelmed that she can't think clearly. She becomes frightened. She becomes depressed and non-functional. She just doesn't function. She will just sit and do nothing. When others come out, I don't always know what's happening. What happens to me is I get pulled in. I feel like I'm just shutting down. I'm very far away. I have no conscious awareness of what's going on out here.
Keep very still.
When Gretchen switches to another personality, she is often unconscious while the other personality is in control. Sometimes she loses hours, sometimes a whole day. Gretchen communicates with her other personalities by writing back and forth in a journal. Each personality has a different handwriting.
I requested when we started this that please, when someone is out, will they please write the date, the day, and the time, and where they were, who they might have seen, if they would please give me an idea of where the body's been.
Not all personalities are aware of each other. Some might believe that they are the only one, while others may be aware of several. Some can see what is happening while another person is out, and yet another will lose time completely until the next time they emerge.
Because it was hard for me not to know where this body's been, to come out and find myself in a place, or realize that half a day's gone. Did we go to class? Did we meet who we were supposed to meet?
Gretchen is troubled by disturbing images and having feelings of uncontrollable panic. As Gretchen studied one night in the library, someone nearby began to clean with a vacuum. The sound caused her to panic, and she started to run. We tried to help.
While certain sounds can be triggers for multiple personality disorder, it is also possible that Gretchen has misophonia, a disorder that was unknown at the time this video was taken. Misophonia is caused by disruption in the connectivity in parts of the brain that process both sound stimulation and the fight or flight response. It also involves parts of the brain that code the importance of sounds.
Gretchen experiences panic attacks that are triggered by certain sights and sounds. The attacks can happen any place, at any time.
What are we gonna do?
What do you need to do?
Can I go somewhere safe? Go somewhere safe.
Hate.
Gretchen is mutilated by a personality that feels she should be hurt and punished. The mutilation takes the form of cutting and happens outside of Gretchen's knowledge or control.
She got pretty seriously and left it in the book for me. I mean, when I came out, I was a mess. I was covered. And the book was covered with blood.
One night, Gretchen was working in the art studio at school when a destructive personality took control. She found herself with cuts on her arm and blood on her clothes. Gretchen returned to school to see what had happened.
What happened here, Gretchen?
Oh, we got cut. Last I remember, it was 10:30 or 11 o'clock at night. And I don't remember anymore. I didn't know that we'd been cut till the next afternoon. I need to clean this up.
Okay. The mutilation has been happening for years. Hundreds of cuts have been inflicted on Gretchen's arm and on other parts of her body. But this cutting is more serious than most. Her life is becoming unmanageable and dangerous.
The personality that hates Gretchen may stem from another part of herself, like the personality that is assertive and emerges in difficult situations. The harmful personality may blame Gretchen for an incident in the past, believing she could have stopped it.
I need to know what happened to me so that I can deal with it and heal from it. I can't heal from something I don't know what it's about. I need to understand it as best I can so that I can go on with my life.
Gretchen traveled 2,000 miles to get specialized treatment at a psychiatric hospital in Texas, which has a specialty in treating multiple personality disorder.
There's one thing to get a memory.
Hospital therapy focuses on recovering repressed memories. Like Gretchen, everyone here is struggling to come to terms with the truth about their past.
Being able to accept what you're getting, your memories, may mean that you also have to accept something about someone you don't want to. What's the most painful thing about it?
Believing that that really happened.
To you?
To this body. I know I could hear the screaming in my head to run, but there wasn't anywhere to run. I was in a corner, I think, except that I can see my body as a child, as it was.
Gretchen explained her increasingly vivid flashbacks to her therapist at the hospital, who is Kevin Hinckley.
You've been asking for a long time. Years you've been asking inside to get memories, to complete memories, to know what's going on in there. And now it's happening.
It feels real close.
Come to the point where I pretty much accept that something happened to me and that I was sexually abused. when I try to think that of who it might be, and I'm getting closer and closer to feeling like I may know who that might be, or it may probably be. That doesn't fit with what I know that I experienced, and that I saw, and that I hear, and that I. Everything fits, but it doesn't fit.
It can be very difficult to retrieve traumatic memories, not only because things may be skewed from a child's perspective, but also because hypnosis, even self-hypnosis, can sometimes cause false memories. Aside from the obvious problems that might arise from this, it also means that a person will stop therapy before finding the true cause or memory.
I had a wonderful life. I have lots of happy memories. I have lots of wonderful things in my childhood.
The legs go up to a white shirt.
In therapy, personalities began to emerge who had experienced abuse that Gretchen herself didn't remember. Kevin asked questions to try and piece together what had happened.
Is there a beard on the chin?
No.
No beard?
A personality who was a frightened child remembers the approach of someone who hurt her.
If I get real small, if I get real, real small, nobody.
The memories became increasingly vivid and were experienced as if the abuse were actually happening. Past and present were indistinguishable.
We're still in Texas. It's 1992. You're safe. But I know this is a real scary memory. What are you seeing?
Big hands.
Big hands? What's happening with the big hands?
I'm back in the wall.
When the experience was too much to bear, the child personality tried to escape into the wall.
Big hands.
Uh-huh.
Big hands.
When alter personalities have memories and relive abuse, Gretchen herself gets closer to remembering what happened to her.
Who's here?
It's myself. The best thing about journal writing is me just come popping out. That's my writing. See, I go on for pages. That's Gretchen's writing.
You used to hurt Gretchen?
I would do anything to destroy anything she did and to hurt her in any way I could. And I used to be one of those inside that belittled her and called her names and swore at her and hurt her. I cut the shit out of her. And I'm very good at it. I'm the one who severed the artery and the four tendons.
Why did you do that?
I wanted to kill her. I hated her.
What did she do?
I stopped growing at 14 because that's when she began becoming interested in boys and dating and all of that. And I hated it. I didn't want any part of it. So I quit. I wasn't going to be any more than 14. Because nobody was ever going to touch me. And whenever that would happen with Gretchen, it would hurt me and I would hate it. I would hate her. And I would hate her for letting that happen. I cut her.
We have to be able to build Gretchen's self, her sense of her own control, her ability to resist the urges to switch, the urges to cut, the urges to have to mutilate.
And Gretchen's case was discussed in a hospital staff meeting where therapists and psychiatrists consult and make therapeutic decisions.
I think she's experiencing a lot of anxiety because her body, she says, why is my head hitting the wall? Why is somebody cutting my arm? Is she aware of why all of this is happening to her physically?
She's slowly coming to grips with that. One of the things that I've tried to have her understand is that internally she has a tremendous pressure that's going on. That there's a tremendous conflict between those inside that have carried the memories for so long, who want other people to know what happened to them, that they no longer want to carry these memories. There's a tremendous pressure for them to tell their stories about what occurred.
Gretchen's situation is difficult. In cases where the personalities are similar, or can at least be neutral towards one another, switches can be more easily managed, or at the very least, less traumatic. But for those like Gretchen, there is the added stress of constantly being under threat by someone who wishes to do you harm. This is both mentally and physically taxing and makes it much harder for the personalities to integrate.
Gretchen's memories were still blocked, and the impasse was beginning to affect the progress of her therapy. Other personalities needed to be reached so their memories could bring her closer to a cure. Gretchen was given a drug called sodium amytal, which acts like a truth serum. The drug helps break through resistance to remembering the past.
Okay, how about that?
This type of therapy is hardly ever used today due to the debatable accuracy and ethical concerns.
She was restrained because some personalities could be violent.
The incident we were talking about yesterday with Gretchen as a child in the corner and the legs coming in. What do you know about that?
Yes, they're still there.
Okay. Stay with the bathroom for a moment. Then what happened?
They,
Need everybody to stay in the bathroom this time. Let's finish this.
They moved in the bathroom over to us.
And then what?
Then there was a penis in our mouth.
Yeah.
Yuck!
Whose penis was it?
I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, what do you see?
My jaw hurts, my mouth hurts, I can't breathe.
Memories began to surface about oral and vaginal abuse that had occurred in a bathroom. So far, these were the most specific and detailed memories to come out. But then, another personality named Enigma appeared, a dangerous personality at the core of Gretchen's self-destruction.
Enigma, what happens to you if the puzzle gets solved? Huh? Are you punished in some way?
I'll kill her before you kill her! I'll kill her before you kill her!
Guess what? The good news is I'm not going to kill her. There's no punishment. I'm not going to hurt her. And I have no intentions of killing her. We're going to keep her safe. And that's where I need your help.
She belongs in the bed.
No, she doesn't.
She belongs in the bed.
No, no, that's what the abuser said. And it was not true. Enigma's job is to kill the body should these memories come out. And you hear halfway through the interview her saying, I'll kill her before you do. Makes me wonder if there was some kind of threat that says, if you ever talk, we'll kill you.
And this is kind of what I look like. That's about how old I am, that picture. She looks pretty happy.
Gretchen was exhausted after therapy, so an untroubled child personality emerged.
This is a picture I cut out.
How old are you?
I'm 8. We haven't had a very good couple of days. Everyone's been up in arms.
Yeah, what's been going on inside?
Well, I don't know all of the details, but there's been a lot of people that are upset and hurting inside, and hurting stomachs and hurting throats, and the worst part is hurting hearts. Sometimes our hearts, we have hurting hearts. But I try to just help out. Plus, I get to have some fun myself. If I'm out, I get to do something. I don't always have to work.
Gretchen was unaware of the memories that had been revealed in therapy. The next step was for her to learn about the abuse that had always been too painful to remember.
She doesn't understand that it was small. Do you understand that?
Tell
me. I'm still thinking maybe.
As we walk through this.
What of the others?
Pay attention to this, but also be aware of what's going on inside you, hurt. Okay?
Oh, man. Don't ask too much of me, Kevin.
One of the others that also hurt. One that Gretchen doesn't understand is why the body wasn't able to fight more back then.
In the bathroom, over to us.
Kevin asked Gretchen to watch videotape of the therapy so she would know what her other personalities had remembered.
The hands.
But when Gretchen began to hear details of her abuse, her mind began to block the experience. This is how Gretchen protected herself when she was a child.
And then what?
Then there was a penis in her mouth.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Stay in the bathroom.
Okay, stay connected here. What are you feeling right now?
You're hurting me!
I know.
Get off my feet! Get off my feet!
Minutes later, confronted with the abuse, the violent personality of Enigma emerged in a rage.
Do not touch his face! Do not touch his face!
Is that what happened during the abuse? It is, isn't it?
Go ahead, kill this body. Go ahead, kill this body. We shall always remain! We shall always remain Enigma! We shall always be Enigma! We shall always be!
You're not evil. And you're not a demon. I don't know what you were taught, but it's not true.
Somebody out there to get the door?
I had an idea that this might happen. This is a real common reaction when things have been so far repressed down inside and then they see it on videotape for the first time or hear it for the first time. Suddenly it becomes very real and they know that things happen. It makes it, the denial melts away and they're faced with the reality of the trauma and the pain. And it can be a real shock. In an outpatient setting, this may take place over weeks and months. In a hospital setting, we have the ability to present it to them right away, where the shock is greater, but they get over it more quickly, and then understand what happened to them. What was going on at the time that you disappeared? What was the last thing you remember?
I was getting some threats and getting...
Later in the day, Gretchen had recovered. Kevin spoke with her and reassured her that she would prevail and succeed in her recovery.
I hear you. And part of what we're going to hope to get to is where you get to find out that you don't have to leave and you may be stronger by staying. Because you are more powerful than you think you are. Are you safe?
I'm fighting for my life. I'm fighting for the survival of this body. And more than just the survival of this body. I don't want to just survive. I have been just surviving for a long time. This is no way to live. I would like to begin living and feeling and not just existing.
Bachelor of Arts with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereunto.
After 4 months of treatment in Texas, Gretchen returned home and finished college, graduating summa cum laude in the top 1% of her class. She now feels she knows who her abuser is, and therapy is helping her heal and gain control of her life. Gretchen plans to continue with her education. Who does the shooting?
I do. Scout does. Doc does.
Who are they?
They're various alters that I have.
John is an expert marksman. He was an Army Ranger and sharpshooter. At target practice, his alter personalities take turns shooting. John's personalities have different styles of firing a gun. Scout shoots from one knee.
What is your function in the system?
My function?
Yeah.
I act as the observer, the scout.
How do you help John?
John's alters are separated into roles. At least several of them seem to serve a specific purpose, such as Scout, the Observer. The alters appear to change places seamlessly. Unlike Gretchen, John is aware at all times, and his alters work together as a team, rather than attacking the main personality. This contrast shows how wildly this order can vary from person to person.
Excuse me?
How do you work with John? How do you help John?
I give him the information he needs from time to time. The information that he's overlooked or has not noticed.
4005.
John shares his job as a police officer with several personalities who have different abilities. He switches when different police skills are needed and is always aware of what his other personalities are doing.
When you're out here driving around at night, who does what?
Yeah, it just sort of depends on the situation. Normally, I'm out quite a bit of the time. Oh, come on.
What are we doing?
Pickup truck over here matches something we've been looking for, possibly on a stolen auto.
As John began pursuit, he switched to a personality who is good at driving in high-speed chases.
He's weaving pretty fast, too. All
right.
When the stop was made, there was another switch, and John returned to confront the driver of the truck.
Warning. You know how fast you were going? You don't have any idea? Does your odometer work on here?
Yeah, my dashlight's got burnt out.
Dashlight's got burnt out. I paced you at over 75 miles an hour.
Among his fellow officers, John has a good reputation. Lieutenant Pritchard is his commanding officer.
John knows what's going on when he's out there in any given situation. He's able to make decisions on his feet in tough situations and just think really fast.
And this is while we were in St. Louis at the training academy. It's my rookie dog and me, the rookie handler. We worked patrol together for 4.5 years. Best partner I ever had, much better than any two-footed partner I ever worked with.
John showed us his scrapbook of 13 years as a police officer. He's had many awards and commendations, which began early in his career.
In 1982, I was awarded the Outstanding Officer of the Year Award by the JCs, which is an award that's offered every year.
Hi.
While he was showing us the scrapbook, John switched to a 10-year-old personality named Johnny.
Hi.
John had trained his dog to stay out of the living room, but when he switched, the dog entered, sensing that his master was no longer present.
Okay, that's John.
Who's John?
He's an adult, and he's a policeman.
The child personality of Johnny recognizes John in the photograph and sees him as a separate person.
Awarded as the...
Johnny read the article from the scrapbook and, like a 10-year-old, had trouble understanding the words.
Enforcement officer of 1982 by the Jakey's
When John switched back, the dog recognized him and left the room as he had been trained. John has been divorced 3 times and now lives alone. He's had problems with depression and unexplainable mood swings, especially controlling his temper.
While John has somehow managed to have a highly successful career, his relationships have suffered. This might be due in part to the fact that living with someone who has multiple personalities can be exhausting to keep up with, especially if one or more does not like you. The social stigma at that time could have also been a factor, as well as the fact that John has trouble regulating his temper.
John used to have a drinking problem, but has been sober for years.
Did you ever go back after him? Was that okay or not?
I tried.
Yeah.
John's therapist is Julie Clark, who has been treating him since his diagnosis.
Push face first, okay?
Several years ago, John began having flashbacks of being abused as a child. He began therapy, and soon after, different personalities began to appear. John was hospitalized with a diagnosis of post-traumatic stress and multiple personality disorder. Since then, personalities with memories of abuse have come forward.
While separate disorders, because of the trauma tied to multiple personality disorder, they often go hand in hand. It is important to remember that not everyone with multiple personality disorder has PTSD, and not everyone with PTSD will develop multiple personality disorder.
Like Edward, who remembers being shoved down a staircase.
How many years older was he?
10.
That's a lot of years.
Not anymore. No.
The abuse his alter personalities remember was never known by John himself. He has only vague memories of growing up.
My memories of childhood are real limited. It's more like a framework. And I can tell you where I went to school. And maybe a little bit about some of the later grades. Along about 7th and 8th grade, I can fill in some blanks.
What John can remember is a stable home and being well provided for. He also remembers the voices that have always existed inside his mind.
I've always been aware that there were voices, okay, that I spoke with and that spoke to me. But I thought that was subconscious or thoughts or however you want to put it, I'm not real sure. It seemed natural, seemed normal.
The voices John heard were those of his 20 personalities. Many of them are frightened children who appear only in therapy.
John's belief that it is typical to hear voices is normal. All children, unless shown otherwise, believe their experiences to be universal. For instance, those that are born with chronic pain or who develop it in early childhood often say nothing because they think that is how they are supposed to feel.
5-year-old Hans was tortured with electricity.
Mm-hmm. How did he hurt you, Hans?
Electricity? Yeah.
Do you remember how he did that? It's okay to say the words here.
With the box.
With the box?
Uh-huh.
Electrical box? Or another kind of box?
The box.
What do you do with the box? You only have to see it for a few minutes. Let yourself see the pictures. I know you don't like it. And you know what? It's not happening today. You're here with me in the office.
Hans' cries of pain only encouraged his abusers. Then John would switch to an emotionless personality named Eugene, who did not feel the pain.
How was the electricity applied?
To the body.
How and where?
It was applied by a hand-cranked type generator with wires attached to various locations depending upon what was being used at the time.
As Edward, John exhibits symptoms that can easily be confused with schizophrenia. The emotionless voice and lack of facial expression, coupled with the slow, exaggerated eye blinking, would otherwise call for such a diagnosis. This is one of the reasons why so many people confuse the two disorders.
In general, to the hands and feet, at times to the stomach, at times to the genital area.
John was also sexually abused by both male and female perpetrators, including a priest. He created a personality whose job it was to have sex.
What else did he have you do?
To lick it.
To lick it? Did you have any feelings when that happened?
I didn't like it.
Okay.
It smelled bad. I didn't like that.
Okay. And you don't have to do that again either.
Oh, over here. Okay.
I don't know. I just got curious, so I called. I found out right behind that trash can right there outside the door. I went to throw something in it, and I seen it. Without thinking, I picked it up, okay? And then I brought it in here later.
In addition to street patrol, John works on different assignments, like this search for a murder weapon. He also investigates many child abuse cases and has been appointed to a county task force setting standards for their investigations.
It's very obvious that my perpetrators will never be prosecuted at this stage in my life. There is no physical evidence that would link back to anyone ever having done anything to me at any given point in time in my childhood. There'd be no way to prove it in a court of law. At least I'm making a difference, even as small as it is, in the area that I'm in. But there is a difference made. And maybe there's one perpetrator out there that will go to prison and he'll be known, or she'll be known. Maybe that makes a difference in some child or some woman's life. So that's real important to us.
Did you notice the use of the word us? The fact that John uses the plural pronoun shows a belief that he and his alters are separate people. Once all personalities have been fully integrated, the person will usually not refer to themselves that way again.
On a Saturday morning in a large northwestern city, Barb and her family are shopping for groceries. Barb and Pat have been married for 9 years and have 3 daughters. Today they're with Hannah, who is 9, and Lori, who is 6.
This isn't what you want, huh?
Pat is off work on weekends from his warehouse job, and Barb manages their household.
I know you like candy, but that's not what we're buying today. Okay, well, you guys get to pick two cereals, so you each get to pick one. Stop. Let them up.
As they come to the breakfast food section, the children's cereal there appeals not only to her daughters, but to a child within Barb, a 5-year-old personality named May.
What do you like?
I'm going to get that one, but not if it's not the strawberry one I want.
You don't want a strawberry one?
No, I don't want one if it's not.
Oh, it's got to be strawberry, huh? Well, let's find out. Let's see what strawberry.
When Barb switches to the personality of May, her eyesight changes. Barb's vision strawberry? Needs to be corrected by strong glasses, but May can barely see through them.
Oh, you don't want to wear Barb's glasses? Okay, there you go.
It needs to be understood that Barb's eyesight has not actually changed. It is more likely that she did not wear them as a child, or that this personality thinks that only old people need glasses.
Okay,
put them in the box. No, just two of them, girls. No, just two cereals.
I like those ones, Hannah.
Barb's daughters are familiar with May, and Pat, who sees her often, treats her like the child she almost literally is. Her language and thoughts are those of a 5-year-old.
I was thinking if we wanted some cookies.
I think we have some cookies. I think we have lots of cookies. We have some chips and stuff, too.
Watch how Pat treats Barb. He never raises his voice or acts annoyed. He seamlessly treats her like he would his daughters, never doing anything to stress the May personality.
Okay?
Yeah.
We're ready to go now. Do you want to go get Barb now?
Well, everyone, buy me something else, like something.
I think this is good for now, okay? We'll get you something else next time.
Okay.
Here you go. She didn't want to wear them.
Once Barb takes over for May, Pat instantly treats her as an adult. Unlike feeding a delusion, this response gives someone with multiple personality confidence and assurance in their relationship. Dealing with any type of illness, whether it be mental or physical, is always better when there is a solid support network.
When Pat and Barb were married, Barb had been in therapy for severe depression, but no one suspected that she had other personalities.
Well, we were in bed one night, and she woke me up because she wasn't sleeping. She was sitting in bed, and I sat up, and she asked me who I was. I said, I'm Pat, I'm your husband. And she said, I don't have a husband, I'm only 9 years old. What are you doing in my bed?
Barb knows almost nothing about her other personalities. Her mind protects her with amnesia from knowing things that would be traumatic or upsetting. Barb is now 34. And has virtually no memories before the birth of her children.
What is your first memory?
My first memory. Clear memory, something that I really know is a memory. I guess it would be when Pat and I were driving in the car. We were on our way to a Lamaze class, which he usually slept through, and we were trying to come up for a name for the baby, and all of a sudden he said something about his grandma Hannah, and I said, that's the name I want to name the baby.
How old were you?
23.
Barb developed multiple personality disorder because she needed to cope with the tremendous disparity between the life that her family expected her to reflect to the outside world and what was actually going on in that household.
Barb's therapist is Stephen Feldman, who is an acknowledged expert in the treatment of multiple personality disorder.
Her father was a prominent, successful dentist. He was a professor at the university. He had a flourishing private practice. Her mother was a professional. And for all intents and purposes, they were the model family.
But Barb's family was profoundly troubled. Notes from a psychiatrist who counseled Barb as a child suggest that her home life was chaotic, and that Barb's mother dealt with the family's problems mainly by denying they existed.
As in the previous two cases, Barb's disorder most likely stems from childhood trauma. It's very interesting that several of her personalities are children. It may be a coping mechanism enabling her to experience the happy childhood that she was denied.
Barb developed an ulcer, and when she was 13, had the first of several abortions performed during her teenage years.
I think that she was tortured for years and years and years. I think that she was physically abused, sexually abused, psychologically abused. Her father was a very sadistic and horrible person.
I've got something in my pocket that belongs across my face. I keep it there.
Barb's amnesia for her childhood enables her to live free from the burden of her past. But her abuse is not really forgotten. Those memories exist in the minds of her other personalities, personalities who lead different lives. When an alter personality takes control, Barb may disappear for days at a time. She finds herself far from home, occasionally in other states, and once in Canada. When this happens, Barb experiences a total loss of time.
Doing some people on it?
I'm gonna do something funny.
It's now I can do it.
But I'm not done.
Barb's personalities are different ages. Her daughter's games cause Barb to switch to a child personality, who emerges because she is most suited for play.
What's on there?
Oh.
Switching often happens in response to changes in Barb's environment.
What's that? What's that?
Lori's used to her mother's other personalities, but the switches are not so easy for her husband, Pat.
Make it have a foot shape on it.
Don't do that, May. It's not good to have that in your mouth.
Go away.
I'm going to go away.
Okay.
It's hard because here I am still wanting to act toward her like her husband, you know, and I get pushed away. And, you know, that gets real confusing and real hard to do sometimes. You know, I got to sit back and realize, well, this isn't my life. I can't do this. I can't just come up behind her and hug her. Because there are some alters that don't want to be hugged, you know, don't want to be touched.
Oh my gosh, never mind. A-N-K-H.
Often, Pat must care for their three daughters and manage the house alone. The children have learned to accept their mother's absences, the times when Barb has switched to another personality.
You haven't touched your burger yet, Lori.
Mm-hmm.
Have you?
Lori, what did
you do? Some of Barb's personalities don't relate to the family. One of them is a teenage girl named DJ. DJ is different than Barb in her posture, voice, and language, and also smokes, a habit Barb dislikes. DJ also has different thoughts and feelings.
How do you feel about Barb's children in terms of whether they're your children or not your children?
They're not. I mean, I care about them and stuff. But they're not my kids. They're Barb's.
DJ emerges when Barb needs to drive, because driving makes Barb nervous. DJ is emotionally stronger and has memories that Barb doesn't. Memories of abuse.
He's a dentist, right? And he'd drill on her teeth, drill on other parts of her body with his dentist drill.
DJ is an interesting alter. Clearly, Barb couldn't have one of her child alters drive for her, but neither could she use a full-grown adult. Instead, a teenager emerges. Normally, this is an age of self-assertion and independence, and also a beginning to draw away from one's family.
Beat the shit out of her, you know, kick her and shit like that.
When Barb couldn't run from her father, she escaped into her mind, leaving another personality to experience and contain the worst memories of torture.
Like burned up. Kitty.
He burned up a kitty? Was it your kitty? That was your gray one.
The emotional pain that Barb experienced as a child is isolated in the personality of 7-year-old Audrey, who is locked in the past.
Now, close your eyes. Now, you know that I'm holding your hand right here in this room, right? And I wasn't there when you all were really little and Roger was there, was I? I wasn't there. So if I'm holding your hand, then you have to be here in my office with me, don't you? Okay.
Many of Barb's personalities are involved in therapy, but some are resistant and difficult to deal with.
I don't get a fucking thing to say.
The last time when you were breaking stuff, you said when you start hearing all those things going on inside, all that chaos going on inside, that it makes you do that stuff to try and quiet everything down.
I don't want to talk about nothing.
Why?
Because I don't.
Why?
As a small girl, Barb was physically unable to fend off the abuse. And because she knew that boys were stronger, Barb created male personalities who could fight. Devin is a teenage boy.
Why don't you just fucking leave me alone?
Barb's father was not her only abuser. He frequented the local bars where he made friends that shared his interests.
My father would bring people home that were also, you know, open-minded and interested in having sex with a young girl. There were a lot of men that were. And he would have me have sex with them. Sometimes he would ask me to tell them that I was a virgin. That seemed to heighten their interest. And he would get paid.
Let's see. This is more her style of a tank top. Okay. This is mine.
Barb created a personality which made it easier to tolerate her abuse. A personality with different feelings about her body.
And what's your name?
Carrie.
When Carrie is out, there can be serious problems. She feels no responsibility to the family and has caused difficulties for years.
Very different.
There's always been money missing. You know, I've been, and it's always a couple hundred dollars at a time, or I had $600 disappear once. I mean, the only thing, it was obvious to me that she spent it, but at the time we didn't know she was a multiple, and she had no explanation. I mean, I had to believe her when she said she didn't know, because it was just too obvious from talking to her that she really didn't know what was going on. Apparently the police have already called Barb and told her that they had gotten reports from like 17 different businesses on return checks and were concerned. I still don't know what's going on with that. I haven't talked to anyone myself about it. All right.
Unknown to Barb or anyone, hello. Carrie has written $1,500 worth of bad checks, money the family doesn't have. Pat is trying to get a loan from his credit union to pay the debt.
Carrie is an example of how physical danger is not always the greatest concern. An alter can financially devastate a family, and in many cases, there is little recourse. Some couples have set up systems where the person has a separate account to maintain independence, but cannot touch the main account. But this is obviously not a perfect solution.
You have a headache? I'm sorry. Been resting a while?
I got another thing from a credit place.
From a collection agency?
Yeah.
What check was it for?
I don't know. I didn't look.
I know you had an appointment today, didn't you?
Muffin.
Hey, sweetie.
How are you? Fine. And there's another little muffin.
Hey, cutie. Where's my kisses? Where's my kisses?
How was school today?
Come on, you.
Good. Mail too?
Man, three girls that love mail.
That evening, we checked back with the family. Pat got the loan and was able to make good on the bad checks. And in another room, Barb had switched to Carrie again, so we were able to talk with her about what had happened.
What happened to the money?
I spent it.
What did you spend the money on?
I bought clothes and perfume and jewelry, and I just had a good time. Whatever I wanted, ate wherever I wanted to eat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why?
How would you feel if you were in my position?
I don't know. Tell me one more time what your position is.
I am stuck here. I don't have a life. I feel used. I feel very used. I'm only allowed out when it's not something anyone else wants to handle. It's really not fair.
As the only adult alter, Carrie serves another purpose. She embodies the desire to have a normal life and pursues adult interests in a way that Barb has probably never been able to express. Carrie feels used and that her situation is unfair. This is the most adult way that Barb has been able to verbalize her frustration with her past and how she is now having to live.
Other personalities' antagonism toward Barb take even more serious forms.
What we need to do is to get another x-ray and then put another splint on it, but one that'll help protect these fingers from moving mm-hmm. through here. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit too much volume.
In a fit of anger, right, Barb's male personality has punched a concrete wall and broken her hand in four places. And the violence against her can be even more appalling.
Okay. I don't know how it happens. I just find burns on my face and they'll large blisters and it's so painful, you know. Burns really hurt.
Barb's mutilations by other personalities are acts of self-hatred and self-punishment for being abused. Once, after a drug overdose, Barb's car was set on fire from the inside. Later, Barb found herself in intensive care, breathing on a respirator. She had barely escaped with her life. We were with Barb and her family when a dangerous time had come again. Alter personalities were threatening to kill her, so Barb decided to seek protection in a psychiatric hospital.
You just move over. You can sit down. You can sit here.
I think if I didn't have children, it wouldn't be so bad. But for their sake, I mean, I don't know what they would, how they would deal with it if anything else happened. I don't know how they've made it as far as they have and come through as well as they have.
Barb's father is dead. But he has left a legacy of never-ending pain. His abuse has affected all their lives.
Made me real angry at him and at her mom. But like I say, that's past. He's gone. You know, we got to let all that go and just work with what's left. He destroyed her. We got to put her back together. It's terrible, terrible thing he did. I just wish he was here to, you know, to pay up.
Since several of Barb's alters pose a danger to her physically and the children by neglect, a stay in a psychiatric hospital is probably the best choice. There she can be monitored while she is helped through the process of integrating her alters.
The people who have allowed their stories to be told have acted with enormous courage and concern for children who continue to be abused. Their wish is that from the shattered experience of their lives, the reality and consequences of child abuse will become better known and better prevented. Multiple personality disorder shows the extraordinary capacity of the mind to invent ways of bearing the unbearable. And these people also show us that when allowed to give up its secrets, the human mind can heal itself.
While the final outcomes of these patients are unknown, we can hope that they were able to integrate their various personalities and be able to live their lives without the constant struggle. Beyond that, we can learn from these cases. While there is a fascination with the cause, symptoms, and treatment of this disorder, it's important to remember that these are first and foremost people. Maybe we, as individuals, cannot directly contribute to a cure, but we can use our understanding to reduce the stigma that still surrounds mental disorders. We must, because the dark reality is that 1 in 7 children have experienced some form of abuse in the last year. Somewhere out there, there is a new Gretchen, John, and Barb.